of nitpicky things about either units or misspelling your name, that sort of thing. I'm just trying to find something. Let's talk about energy again. Let's quickly review what we know about energy. Real quick review. In chapter 7, we introduced two aspects of this new approach to dynamics. And one was work. We said that work, particular force times displacement times the cosine of the angle between the two, basically the dot product between a force vector and a displacement vector. And so we said that we can add energy to a system by applying a force on the system and moving it a displacement, and that would be the work that we perform on that system. That's adding energy to the system. And one thing that could happen if you add energy to the system is that the object might actually pick up speed. And so there was an energy associated with movement, and we call that energy, kinetic energy. That's equal to 1/2 the mass times the velocity squared or something. So that you could actually change your kinetic energy by doing work on a body. You might have a certain kinetic energy to begin with. Do some work on it and add that amount of kinetic energy to it and have greater speed as a result. That's pretty much all we've talked about so far. So let's take it up from there. I wanted to introduce another kind of energy we sort of hinted at it before, and now we want to introduce it formally, and that is what we call potential energy, and in particular gravitational potential energy. Let's see how this might work. Let's say I start off with a mass at some particular height, some initial height, and I'm going to apply work on that mass. I'm going to apply a force against gravity, and the force I'm going to apply is going to equal to the weight of the mass itself. So I'm just going to apply just enough force so I just barely move it at constant speed upward. So the force I apply is equal to mg. I'm going to do that for some distance d. So I've applied work on this mass equal to mg times d. That's force times distance, mgd. Let me rewrite the distance in terms of the height in this case. Well, we'll say we start at some height, h1, and I'm going to go to another height, h2, and so my distance d is going to be equal to height h2 minus h1. I'm just defining some height from 0, saying ground level 0. So d h2 minus h1, so I could rewrite this, and I could say the work is equal to mg height h2 minus mg height h1. I'm going to define mgh as what I call potential energy, and we're designated by u. Why you? Why not? Why not P? Because we're going to use P for other things. We're going to use P for, have we used P for anything? We use it for power, right? And pushing force. And we're going to use P for momentum in the next chapter. So we've got uses for P. So if we go down the alphabet and try to find a letter that isn't used very much, and we came up with U. So, and it actually looks like what we call a potential well. So kind of goes with potential. Potential energy. So anyway, it's U2, minus U1, or change in potential energy. So we have defined what we now call gravitational potential energy. So potential energy due to a gravitational position as mg times h. What it basically means is that it would take work for me to lift something up to a greater height. And once I've done so, that object at that greater height has the potential to do work back, the same amount of work that it took me to lift it up to that point. So it's got energy stored in the fact that it's at a certain height and has that energy that can be utilized later. So that's one way I could store energy. I mean, if I wanted to, let's say I had an unlimited supply of energy, and at least at the moment, and I wanted to save some of that for later on, one thing I could do is use that unlimited supply and just pump water up to a greater height, maybe in some kind of reservoir, and later on when I'm ready, I can uncork that water, let it fall, and let it turn the turbine to generate electricity. I could utilize that water later on as stored energy for the future. Right? It's not an efficient way of doing it because you're going to lose energy along the way. But if you had unlimited energy, you could do something like that. We do have unlimited energy and source of solar power, but that's another thing. If I had solar collectors, I could just keep on pumping water up to the height and then just store it that way. All I need. And then uncork it, say at nighttime or something. MGH. Now, if I define potential energy in this way, it really matters where I define my reference height. I can define it from anywhere, actually. I could define it from pure ground level. I could say sea level. Or I could just say, some other height, some other level is my ground level, and call that zero level. And say I have a potential energy, positive potential energy, if I go above that level. And for that matter, if I were to go below that reference level, I could have, in effect, negative potential energy. So I go a negative height below that level. But where I choose to reference this potential energy is my choice, my prerogative. But once I've selected that reference, I need to stick to that in the rest of the problem that I do. But I can choose any point be my reference. Another idea concerning this potential energy is that it is energy against gravity. So it only is energy in a vertical sense. I have potential energy against the force of gravity, lifting up to height. So if I go horizontally along that height, or horizontally in any sense, that does not change my potential energy. The potential energy is only vertical, and gravitational potential energy. So, in this case, say if I were on this roller coaster, and I started this height, h2, and eventually I ended up at some height, h1 to h2. How I got there horizontally didn't really matter, and even the fact that I actually went up over this hump came down here, that didn't really matter either. That eventually, I had this much potential energy, and now I've got this much potential energy. I lost a certain amount of MGH here between the two heights. So horizontal distance would have no effect on what we call gravitational potential energy. It's only the height involved. Here's another example of that. Consider a mass on an incline that's about to slide a distance of d down this incline. Let's say the angle of the incline is theta. What we could say is our potential energy is mgh if we define h from some reference level, and h is our pure height above that level. So even though we're going to go a distance d down this incline, what is particularly important to us is how far down the incline do we go in terms of height. So here we'll say that where we stop here is our zero reference level, and h is our pure height above that level. Now I could say that h is equal to d sine theta, where d is our hypotenuse of this right triangle. So h is the opposite side of theta. So h is equal to d sine theta, and that would be correct if I were given d. But the point here is that h is what's important. What is my pure height vertically in a gravitational field? And in this particular case, I chose my reference to be at the end of my this distance d, because that's something where I knew I was going to be. And I just made it convenient for me to just choose that as my zero potential energy level at a height of zero. And so everything was defined above that point. Why do we have this thing called potential energy? Why have we made this up? Because in our everyday lives, that's what we're dealing with. We're in a gravitational field, so we can think of things as having the potential to do work if we raise them up a certain height. And so gravity is a part of our life. And gravity itself has a certain value associated with it. It is called a conservative force. And if you find a conservative force, you can account for that force by making it responsible for a potential energy. And hence, then you don't have to deal with that force as a separate force. You can think of it in terms of potential energy. So we need to define what a conservative force is. For a conservative force, the work done against that force is independent of the path taken to go from point A to point B. And for any cyclic path, the work done is zero. For instance, for a conservative force, let's say if I were to travel, let's say this was point A, and I were to travel to point B, if there were no losses along the way, if there was no force against me to take away energy, then I could say that I made from A to B in a conservative way. And if there were forces along the way, but if they worked against me and stored energy at this point, then I came back and reutilize that energy and came back to the point where I started, then I would say that is a conservative force. It didn't take energy away from me as I went in a cyclic manner back to my starting point. And that's what gravity is. If you're point A in a gravitational field and you go up to a greater height, you gain in potential energy, but you can gain that energy back by going back to where you started. And by utilizing that energy of due to gravity, it's conservative. We ignore air friction because that's not conservative, but that's not part of gravity. So we're ignoring air friction in this vertical sense, and just the gravity itself is a conservative part of that cycle. So to deal with gravity, rather than try to calculate the work done by gravity all the time, either positive or negative work, we're just going to think of it as a potential energy, MGH. As an example of a non-conservative force, friction is not conservative. It leads to loss of mechanical energy, and it's dependent on the path taken. I know I have a non-conservative force. If I start at point A with a certain amount of energy, I move to point B, and somehow I make it back to A, and I find that as a result of my path, I've lost energy. I don't have the same amount of energy as when I started. So along the way, some force has taken energy away from me, and basically the culprit would be friction. If we have only conservative forces, if we're dealing with a situation where we have only conservative forces present, then we can extend the idea of conservation of energy to just a mechanical sense, and we can have mechanical conservation of energy. And we write like this. If only conservative forces are present, then the energy present will be a constant and will be equal to our kinetic energy plus our potential energy. Our kinetic energy of motion plus any potential energy that we have stored due to conservative forces. This would be a constant. This is a very, very useful idea. Let me write the general equation for this. We have two arbitrary points, A and B, and we have a conservation of mechanical energy. So we have point A, point B. Energy is conserved, and we can just say that the energy at A should equal the energy at B. And in full form, I can write like this. I would say the kinetic energy at A plus the potential energy at A, all the energy at A, should equal the kinetic energy at B plus potential energy at B, all the energy at B. What is nice about this is it doesn't matter in this sense, how I got from A to B. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what path I took. It doesn't matter how long it took me. All I need to do is look at A, evaluate A, look at all the energy at A, focus in on it. What's the kinetic energy? What's the potential energy at A? And look at B, focus in on that. What's the kinetic energy and potential energy at B? And if there's conservation of energy, set them equal to each other. And I don't have to worry about the time it took, the path it took. I don't have to worry about everything in between. What a nice tool. And we can do dynamics problems doing this. Just look at one point, another point, and comparing the two. In case of mechanical energy of a freely falling body, what we would say is at point A, we have kinetic energy. We might have some velocity at point A, so its kinetic energy would be 1/2 the mass times velocity at A squared. And it might have some height at A, whatever that is, mg height at A, so that's our potential energy at A. So we add up all this energy, and that's our energy at A. And if there's no friction involved, no non-conservative forces, then that total should be the same as the total we have at B. So whatever kinetic energy we have at B, 1/2 mass times velocity B squared, plus any potential energy at B, mg height it be. This is a very nice equation. You can see I could probably, if it's one mass, I could probably knock the mass off on both sides, but I don't want to get in that habit because we are going to introduce another potential energy that doesn't have mass in it in a moment. And then if you've got that habit, you might get into a bad habit. So we'll just keep the masses in there for this point. Let's try this out. Here's a problem number six, or at least close to problem number six in your book. Dave Johnson, the bronze medalist at the 1992 Olympic decathlon in Barcelona. Maybe this problem isn't in there anymore. Might be getting pretty old here. Leaves the ground at the high jump with a vertical velocity component of 6 meters per second. How far does the center of mass move up as he makes the jump? Dave Johnson, who won the bronze medal in the 1992 Olympic decathlon in Barcelona, leaves the ground at the high jump with a vertical component of 6 meters per second. So how do we figure this out? How high does he go? Well, let's select his initial height when he first leaves the ground. Let's select that as being point A. And we'll say that his final height, when he finally reaches as high as he's going to go, we're going to select that as point B. So we're going to compare just 2 points, the center of mass at point A and the center of mass at point B. We set up our equation. We say that all the energy he has at point A must be kinetic energy plus potential energy, should equal all the energy he has at point B, which would be his kinetic energy plus potential energy at point B. Once I set up this equation, I wish to simplify. Ultimately, I want to find his height at B. That's what I want to find. What things do we know that would simplify this equation, make it easier to solve? It takes off. We do know he takes off with a velocity of 6 meters per second. So we know that that is his velocity at point A. That'd be initial velocity, that's velocity at A. What about the initial height?
You could set it at 0.
We can set it at 0, why not? Let's set it at 0. I mean, we could say it's 3. That'd be fine too. And then the height of B would be 3 plus whatever distance he went up. Well, let's just set it to 0. And that way we can get rid of this term. What about the velocity at point B?
0.
Also 0, because you're only going to go as high as you're going to go and no higher. So he reaches the maximum height when his vertical velocity reaches 0. So already, two of these terms are gone. That one's 0, that one's 0. Equation simplifies to this. All the kinetic energy he had at point A is being transferred into potential energy at point B. How he got there doesn't matter. What happened along the way when kinetic energy was being transformed into potential energy doesn't matter. We select 2 points, and now all this energy became all this energy. And the other thing that wasn't given in the problem was his mass, but we can see in this point the mass will cancel out on either side. Solve this for the height at B. So the height at B will equal 1/2 the initial velocity squared divided by G, 9.8. Put in the values. You can see that Dave Johnson can jump, or at least raise his center of mass 1.84 meters, which would be about 5.5 feet. Be pretty good, actually. 5.5 feet. Does anybody know the story of Dave Johnson beyond this problem? No, it's ancient history. probably around the time of somebody being born, but didn't at that time. But, at that time, there was a Nike campaign, and the top two decathletes in the world were Americans. And it was Dave Johnson and Dan O'Brien. And they were the two best decathletes in the world. And so Nike said, okay, we're going to get them both under contract. And heading up to the Olympics, they said, all right, who's going to win in Barcelona? It's going to be Dan or Dave, Dave or Dan. And they had them competing and everything. Problem is that the United States tryouts for the Olympics 1 month before the Olympics. So they went to the United States tryouts, and Dan missed on his first three attempts on the pole vault. And it was like at some low height that he had never missed before, ever. I mean, it's like the easy height was like 14 and a half feet, which is not an easy height for any normal human being, but for a decathlete, top decathlete, it was a simple height. And he scratched on all three. And by scratching all three, he didn't even make the United States Olympics. So he didn't go. And Dave ended up going and winning the bronze. So that was one of those Nike campaigns that didn't quite pay out too well. Here's a special case of this conservation of energy in a gravitational field. And this one comes up quite a lot, so that's why I've actually made up this special case, where you fall from rest to some lower height. We're going to start with a vertical velocity of zero. We're going to fall down and eventually reach some lower height, and we want to figure out what our velocity is at the lower height. So we'd set up our conservation of energy equation, and we have point A and point B, and we don't worry about how we got between the two, but we just have A as at some height, H, and B we're going to define as our zero height. So we'll say there's no potential energy at B based on definition, and we'll get rid of this MGH to B, then H and B will be zero. Something else is also zero as well. What would that be?
Initial velocity.
Initial velocity. We're going to start with initial velocity of zero, velocity at A. So immediately we get rid of two terms, and it simplifies the equation. So we just say that our potential energy at A, MGH, is equal to our kinetic energy at B, 1/2 the mass times velocity squared. All this energy transferred into energy of movement down here. And the masses would cancel out. Solving this for the velocity at point B, multiply both sides by 2, take the square root, and we get that the velocity at point B is equal to the square root of 2gh. This comes up so often that it's a nice little formula to have handy. That if you start from rest and you go down to a lower height, your vertical distance being h, your speed at the lower height, if there's no friction along the way, is equal to the square root of 2gh. And we get it from the conservation of energy. Let's try it out on this problem. Pendulum consists of an object suspended by a string. If the string is 2 meters long, it makes an initial angle of 30 degrees with the vertical. What's the speed of the particle at the lowest point? Well, we're going to approach this as a starting at rest, ending up with some speed problem. We're going to ignore any kind of rotational aspect to this problem. So we're just going to say we're going to start at some height h, and we're going to end up at some zero height, which we're going to define as zero for our final height. So really, all I need to do based on the last result, since our velocity should equal the square root of 2gh, I just need to find out what h is. All right, what's my initial height with respect to my final height? Well, if I look at this triangle here, I have a right triangle here, and the length of the hypotenuse is the length of the string, which is L. So this height on this side of this triangle L cosine of 30 is the adjacent side. And the height of the whole string down to the bottom here is L. So the difference between the two would be L minus L cosine of 30, and that should be this interval right here, this height right there. So I'm going to say h is going to equal L minus L cosine theta. And in this particular case, that would be 2 minus 2 cosine 30, or 0.268 meters. So our pure height for this pendulum, this ball, is 0.268 meters. If I apply that, what is my speed at the bottom of this swing? My velocity is the square root of 2gh, which is square root of 2 times 9.8 times 0.268 meters, and that comes out to 2.29 meters per second. And that's pretty close. We're going to lose some energy to rotational energy. We're not going to worry about that right now. Very close to the actual value. It was a test, right? So no tornadoes. So this is very close to our actual value, 2.29 meters per second. So far, what do we have in terms of energy? We've got work, which we haven't mentioned that in this conservation energy idea yet. Work is energy that we can add to a system, or subtract from a system for that matter. It's force times displacement times the cosine angle between the two. Let's keep that on our back burner. But we do have kinetic energy, which is energy of motion, 1/2 the mass times velocity squared. And now we had this gravitational potential energy, energy of due to height, equal to mgh. And there's one more energy I wish to add to this, another potential energy possibility. That's associated with another conservative force, that being the spring force. What we're going to say is a spring, the ideal spring, can store energy. If you compress the spring, and it's an ideal spring, then all the work you do in compressing that spring down can be stored in the compression of the spring, and then that work can be done later on when the spring releases. So there's stored energy in a compressed spring. And we know from chapter 7 that when we actually did work on a non-constant force, the spring force is not constant, but the work that we did when we compressed the spring was equal to 1/2 kx squared, we recall. And so, in essence, then, all that work that we did is actually energy that is stored in the spring, and so that energy is indeed 1/2 kx squared. That's the energy that the spring can release once it is sprung. Now I have two forms of potential energy. If you have a mass that's going at a certain height, It can store gravitational potential energy, MPH. And if you compress a spring or even extend a spring a distance x from its normal equilibrium value, either compress it a distance x or you can pull on it a distance x, either way, you're going to store energy in that spring because it's going to want to pull back or push back either way. That would be 1/2 kx squared, where x is the distance that you either compress it or extend it. And k is your spring constant. That is a constant intrinsic to that particular spring. Either one or both of these may be used in this conservation of energy equation. So if we have problems that involve springs, we have to take that under consideration in the problem. And that is another form of energy that we have to compare between point A and point B. Let's try another vertical problem. In this problem, a block of mass 0.25 kilograms is placed on top of a light vertical spring of spring constant 5,000 newtons per meter. It's pushed downward, so the spring is compressed 0.1 meters. So we're going to put this mass on top of the spring. So far, everything's fine. We're going to push it down 0.1 meters, so we're going to store energy in the spring. After the block is released, it travels upward and then leaves the spring. To what maximum height above the point of release does it rise? Now this is kind of similar to the last problem that we did, kind of, because we're going to see how high it goes. But let's think about what's going on here. We've got a spring, I'm going to push it down, I'm going to store potential energy into that spring, and then let go. What's going to happen? The spring is going to start to release, it's going to push that mass, and finally when the spring releases all the way back, the mass will leave the spring and actually have kinetic energy as it goes up and up and up and up. And that kinetic energy will be transformed into potential energy of height until at some point that mass will have only gravitational potential energy. Right? So there's a lot of energy going on here. I got stored spring energy, and then it's transferred to the mass where it has kinetic energy, and it goes up to stored gravitational potential energy. But in doing these kinds of problems, we said we only need to select 2 points, A and B. We only need to look at those 2 points and nothing else. So, we're going to look at point A, where the spring is compressed, and point B, where the mass reaches final height. And we're not going to worry about anything in between. So we're not going to worry about any of the points where the mass is actually moving. In the first instance, we just let go. At that moment, the velocity of the mass is zero. Right? No kinetic energy. I mean, the spring has not yet started to decompress. And it does pick up speed along the way, and then finally reaches a final velocity of zero. But that's all in between. So we're just going to compare A to B, not worry about what happens in between. If it's conservation of energy, then A should equal B. So we'll say that the energy of A equals the energy of B. There's no friction, no non-conservative forces. So I can say the kinetic energy of A plus potential energy of A will equal the kinetic energy of B plus the potential energy of B. Now I just need to evaluate what these terms are. If I write it in full form, I might write it like this. The kinetic energy of A, which is 1/2 the mass times the velocity of A squared, plus the potential energy of A, which is actually two things going on. You can have either compressed spring, 1/2 kx squared, plus gravitational potential energy, MGH at A. So two types of potential energy comes into that stored potential energy term. And all this energy at A should equal all the energy at B, which could be in three forms. Kinetic energy, 1/2 mass times velocity B squared, plus spring energy, 1/2 kx² if the spring is compressed or extended, and gravitational potential energy of B. Here's my full equation for conservation of energy in this case. Write it all out. In this particular case, what can I get rid of? Or what, how can I make this easier?
Your initial velocity is zero.
My initial velocity is zero. So my velocity at A is zero. In other words, I just released my hand from the block. At that moment, it hasn't started to move yet. So all the energy is still in that compressed spring. There's no velocity at A. So at that moment, I've got no velocity at A. This term is gone. Final velocity is zero too. Because once I get to B, I'm going to go as high as I go and go no higher, and there's momentarily stop at B. So excellent. There's no kinetic energy involved in A and B here. So those two terms are gone. Thanks, Christian. What else?
Define your height at A to be zero.
Define my height at A to be zero. Excellent. I'm going to define my initial height as zero, and in which case my height at B would be any height above that. Or I'm at point B. So this term I define to be zero. So far so good. Anything else? For which one? Once the spring has sprung, it was sprung no more, and the spring is sprung to zero. I'll say that five times fast. So at point B, X is zero. I mean, the spring is sprung, and what is the past tense for sprung? I guess spring is sprung, sprang the spring? I don't know. But it's sprung, right? Sprang. So X is zero, because it's gone back to its equilibrium position. It's no longer compressed, it's no longer extended. It's zero, so this term is zero. So once I set up this equation, I can just kind of look at some terms and get rid of some stuff. Velocity at zero, final velocity is zero. Define my initial height as zero, as Urban said. There's no spring involved with point B, because the spring is sprang. And now, I've got this. That all the potential energy stored in the spring, 1/2 kx², has now been transferred into gravitational potential energy at point B, mgh. And truly, if I looked at this position, I probably could have jumped to this conclusion. Because that here, all I've got is potential energy in the stored spring. And here, all I have potential energy of height. And that energy should equal that energy. And how I got there in between doesn't matter, even though there was movement in between. Solve this for h. So h is equal to 1/2 kx² divided by mg. Put in my values. 1/2 is 0.5. The spring constant was given as 5,000. X was the compression distance, that was 0.1 meters, square that. The mass was 0.25 kilograms, and of course G is 9.8. So put all those values in there, we get 10.2 meters. So in the absence of air friction, this block will go up 10.2 meters. work will be greatly facilitated if I show you one more thing today. Because the problem set basically utilizes all this knowledge. And then on Wednesday, we will work out a whole bunch of problems. And we're going to utilize all this knowledge with examples on Wednesday. But the last thing I want to introduce today is what I call one equation to rule them all. We set up this conservation of energy equation. We said that this, we can compare A to B, and we say the energy of A to the energy of B, and not worry about anything along the way, if we have conservative forces. So only if we deal with conservative forces like gravity or in spring force, we can store energy in those conservative forces, A equals B. But what happens if we don't have conservative forces? What happens if some energy is lost along the way? Or what happens if we go from A to B, and let's say in the process of going from A to B, somebody does work on your object so that you actually either add or subtract energy along the way? Now, again, we don't really need to know too much about the time involved in that between A and B. We just need to know how much work was done between A and B. So the way we're going to describe this is that for all real situations, we'll say that we're going to start off with some energy. And we'll say our final energy is going to be whatever energy we started with, plus whatever energy was added along the way, either positive or negative. So we're going to say this plus anything along the way equals our final energy. And we'll write it like this. The energy at A plus any work done along the way, positive or negative, equals the energy at B. Or in a full form, the kinetic energy at A plus potential energy at A plus any work done along the way equals our kinetic energy at B plus potential energy at B. This is your one equation to rule all energy equations. So, the way you would do it is you have an energy problem, look at point A, what is the energy present at point A? Evaluate kinetic energy, 1/2 mv². Evaluate potential energy, mgh, or 1/2 kx² for springs involved. Look at what happens along the way. So if there's a force times distance along the way, positive or negative, we'll add that as a work term. And then point B, evaluate kinetic energy and potential energy at point B. This energy plus any work done along the way equals that energy. We don't have to worry about time. So with this idea, any work on the system will equal the final energy we have, the energy at B, minus the initial energy we had, energy at A. Rearranging that equation of work will equal the change in energy, which I could write as work on the system will equal the change in kinetic energy plus the change in potential energy. That's just a sidelight, but that would define what any work we did along the way. If there was no change in energy, then we did no work. Problem-solving strategy. Look at A and B. Define your sources of energy at A and B. It's kinetic energy and potential energy. Kinetic energy is 1/2 mass times velocity squared at either A or B, looking at whatever things are moving. Potential energy is either gravitational potential energy, whatever has height, mgh, or if the spring is involved, 1/2 kx², or both. It's possible you could have both in the problem. So you do that first. Look at A and B, define kinetic energy and potential energy at A and B. Second, select a reference point for your zero height point. Either A or B, it will be convenient. So just decide one point, if one point's higher than the other, decide the lower point to be your reference point of being zero height. That way you can get rid of the potential, gravitational potential energy at one of those points. If no work is done in the system, the initial energy will equal the final energy and you proceed with the problem. But if work is done on the system, then the initial energy plus the work done will equal the final energy. And we have the one equation to rule them all. And you could always use this equation, because if the work done on the system is zero, then that term just becomes zero. So this equation deals with all energy situations. And finally, we want to evaluate the work. What is the work done? Because there's a force along the way, it's force times distance. And for many of these problems, I would say 99% of these problems, your work will be a force times distance and probably no angle between. The angle will either be 0 degrees or 180 degrees. In other words, it's either going to be a force times distance in a positive sense or a force times distance in a negative sense. Cosine of 180 is a negative 1. In other words, if your force is going this way and your displacement is going that way, then that's negative work that's going to be done by that force, most likely friction. Right? So, 99% of your problems is just going to be deciding whether you have a pushing force that's pushing you forward and adding energy to the system for a certain distance d, or whether you have a negative pushing force as you're moving this way, it's pushing against you, and that would be a negative work done, negative force times distance. Of your problems would be like that. In fact, I can't even think of one where in these kinds of situations it's different from that. And as you set this equation up, eliminate the terms that happen to be zero. Solve for the unknown. Unfortunately, I won't show you any examples right now, but I will give you the problem set and see what you can do.